Welcome to What's New SRQ with Melinda Lee, where we focus on everything that is going on in the Sarasota manatee communities. Now, here's your host, Melinda Lee.
Good afternoon. We're back on What's New SRQ with me, Melinda Lee. And on Tuesdays, we talk about people who've reinvented themselves or this idea of reinvention, like recreating who you is, as I say, into a whole new being with time. And my guest today is Robert Gaglio. And there is actually another G in there, but it's silent, so it's easy to mess up. And if people are looking for you, they might misspell it. So welcome, Robert.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
My pleasure. We're all a little tittering here because we've got fresh homemade biscottis that Robert made for us. And that's kind of goes with our theme of his reinvention, which brings him to doing Italian culinary tours. He does culinary tours, key culinary tours here in Sarasota. That's how I actually got introduced to Robert. He was conducting a tour for key culinary services, key culinary tours, and all around St. Armand's Circle. And we were learning all about the history of Sarasota and everything, and you did an amazing job of that. Give me your card. I want to find out more about you. And there's a lot to learn about you, but what I want to do is I kind of want to start at the very beginning and have you tell us a little bit about your career path, because it's an unusual path to go from being a financial planner to having Italian culinary tours as your career. College, you lived in Detroit, and just like a little couple sound bites of where
I'm
you
a baby boomer from the suburbs of Detroit. Lots of Italians live there on the east side of Detroit. I'm from a big family. Back then, I'm 53, so I was on the tail end of that. I went to college only because I looked around and I have a brother who's a master carpenter, and he was so great with his hands even at 17, 18, and I'm like, well, I can't do any of that, so I better go to college. But unlike him, I always saved every penny I made, and he spent everything when we were kids, he had a hole in his pocket. So I go, well, I'm pretty good with money, so maybe I'll go into finance. And I got a finance degree.
That was your major? Okay, finance.
Yeah, Central Michigan University. Went to school, paid for it myself, had to figure it out like most of us did in our generation. Came out and was into real estate, but I found a career in lending, in those types of transactions. But then about 7 years into that, I really worked with high net worth clients all the time. It was kind of a wealth management lending position. And I was more interested in the management of the total wealth of the client. So I moved over into kind of a business development phase where I did more than just lending. I would bring in a trust officer, bring in a portfolio or a financial planner. I would like quarterback a team for these very wealthy clients.
Okay, so here you are. You've got a financial background and you've learned about pulling things together and making things happen. So when did you start to realize that the financial thing just wasn't singing to your soul anymore?
Well,
and you wanted to do something a little different.
Sure. I was living in Cape Coral, Florida that was the epicenter of the crash, right? 2008.
Yeah. Okay. Yippee. That was fun for all of us.
Banking's changed a lot in 10 years. And I think I changed, my mind has drifted from more the analytical to more the creative side. I have a beautiful two kids, a daughter and a son, and my son is the opposite. He's very creative, but he got a finance degree. I mean, he's an artist. And so he's early on in his life really doing a lot of creative stuff, but yet he still went to college for finance. Not my choosing either. He chose that. But I think he'll be an entrepreneur down the road, which will really help him. But for me, it just kind of, over 40 years, it just kind of changed. I went from being more analytical and more driven in sales, kind of driven, and more creative now. I really like, cooking and creating this experience is really kind of an art form, and I really enjoy it. And I was telling you earlier, we do home dinner theater in your home where I narrate stories from a book, How Italian Food Conquered the World. And we have an opera singer come in. So it's very more like...
Well, we'll get into all that in a second.
Yeah.
But you said that there's a story about where the epiphany actually happened.
Yeah.
So tell us about
that. Okay, so almost 10 years ago, right? 2008, there's this big crash. You know, I've always kind of decided what I wanted to do when in my career. Well, guess what? After 25 years of being in banking, I had to kind of, I was told, hey, we're closing this bank. You can't work here anymore, right?
So it was kind of imposed on you.
So, yeah. So I'm like, oh, okay. Fortunately, I had a great relationship with a former employer up in Detroit, and they had a spot in Sarasota. And what you think is the end of the world really turned into a door opening. Now I live in one of the most beautiful communities in the United States, Sarasota. So fast forward 10 years or 5 years, boy, I'm so glad that all happened because I live here now. Right. And then at that point, when you're like, you know, you buy a house at the peak, you lose a job, you know, you're raising teenage kids, divorce, all that stuff thrown in one big stew. And I just said, hey, you know, my son graduated high school. I said, let's go to Italy and see where my grandfather was born. So that's what we did.
The kids. You took the kids.
I took my son. Okay. My daughter was out west, and he had just graduated high school. I said, hey, I'm coming on a big birthday. Let's go celebrate by going to Italy. And we did that. And so this story, I don't know how much, if we have a break here, but the story goes, my father, who's 80, at the time he was 87, takes the back of like a mail coupon that comes in the mail and writes out his aunt, his cousins, his second cousins on this coupon, right? So I'm carrying, and he did a pretty good job, 87, remembering all these names, right? So I got this in my pocket, and we're in, we did Rome, and we flew into Palermo. We're doing a day at the beach. It's nothing like a day at the beach in Sarasota. It's very stressful in Palermo.
Okay, gotcha.
Okay, so it's like 105 degrees. So my son goes, I'm melting. Let's do something different here. So let's go up the mountain and see where my family is. And we pull in this little town, Montalebre, outside of Palermo, up a mountain. There's 5,000 people that live there maybe. And then there's a street with our name on it.
Oh my goodness, so your own street.
We stopped. And I went to the covered stoop where this old lady is and showed her my license and my name, showed her the list. She got her cousin. She didn't speak English. So she gets her phone, says, calling, you know, inglese, cousin. So this cousin comes, ponytail, a short lady. Hi, I'm Joanna. I'm from Windsor, Ontario. I said, what are you doing here? I mean, Windsor is like 60 miles from Detroit, right?
Right.
Windsor, Canada. So she goes, oh, I married an Italian 19 years ago. I have two girls here and I live here now. And I said, well, I'm looking for these people. Can you help me? And she spent the whole afternoon like going, we went to the butcher, the pizzeria, and she found these people. And, I remember, you know, that experience of, it wasn't like they were lost. I mean, my father visited with my mother in 1975, but that was like the last kind of real
time,
communication
then.
Between those two families. So it was 2 days of like, you know, 8-course meals and going up, you know, it was just amazing. Matter of fact, my son gets in the car and he looks at me, he goes, Dad, I can't explain what just happened. You know, like he was so, it was a big emotional.
So isn't that
period.
Interesting how this perfect storm comes together?
Yeah.
The divorce, the job going away, the economy tanking, you know, like all this stuff. And
right.
you could have chosen to just wallow, and you said, I'm gonna live with some gusto, and you took off for Italy.
Sure, yeah.
And then what was the moment in Italy where it was kind of like popped for you?
Right.
And you were like, wow, I got to make a career out of this.
Right. Well, I was really blessed to have this position to come to it with Comerica Bank in 2010. So I was so blessed. And it created an opportunity. You know, I have vacation time and things like that where I could do that. So the following year, I'm like, well, I got to come back and see these people. And because I wanted to. My goal really at the very beginning was to cook a meal in the hometown of my grandfather. That's what I wanted to do.
So the love of cooking was always there,
yes,
too.
Yes, yes. So the next year, my boss says, hey, I got a villa in Tuscany. Will you come stay with us? And I'm like, you got your teenage kids there, your wife? I can't crash your villa, you know, week at the villa. Oh, he insisted. I said, well, let me be the cook. I'll do it, but if I can be the cook. And he loved it because he travels and he pulled out magazine recipes and can you make this? And we'd go to the markets and buy the food, and I prepare. By Wednesday, the wife's like, you know, you could travel with us anytime you want,
right.
You know?
Exactly.
And then I thought, well, this is fun. And then, of course, I went and visited the family. And I've driven probably 20,000 miles in Italy by now. I went all over. But so then the next year I'm like, well, I should just rent a villa and go out and get some of my friends or my business contacts. You know, I had a lot of lawyers that I knew, and we put a house together. And I was the cook, and it was the beginning of the formation of the concept for me. Okay. You know, people do tours over there all the time. They're more like travel agents that tour with their guests, and they go to hotel. What I'm creating is an experience of being there for 7 nights as if you live there. You know, you're
cooking. Like an immersion.
You're immersing in the culture.
Right. Okay. So this is really cool. And this is a really yummy.
So that was the epiphany.
Right. Okay. So this is a great spot for us to take our break, because there is always a break.
Oh, okay.
And, but we'll be back in just a few moments with Robert Gaglio. And it's really fun to be talking to people about them achieving their dreams and reinventing themselves. I'm Melinda Lee. We'll be back with What's New SRQ in just a few minutes. So we're back with What's New SRQ, me and me, Melinda Lee, if I can get it out.
Well, you've got some biscotti in your mouth still.
I still had some crumbs in my mouth. He's catching me on it. So I'm like, yes, thanks, Robert, for calling me on that. Robert Gaglio. And Robert is, the whole first section, we were talking about how all these things throughout your life lead you to where you are today. And especially when people are reinventing themselves, they don't even realize that there is this little spark, this little flicker that happens a long time ago, and you were telling a story during the break about the pasta maker.
Sure, right. When I was 17, I lived in a very Italian neighborhood. My best friend was Italian. His father, I was over there on a Sunday, and he began to make pasta in the basement. We all had kitchens in the basement because there's like a bunch of kids and there's these little homes, right? So everybody ate and cooked in their basement, and I'm sure that's like other Italian communities. So he's making the pasta by his hands, you know, he just pours the flour on the table, makes a little volcano kind of shell, like, you know, mountain, dumps his eggs in the center, a little salt, a little olive oil, and then he just starts to kind of mix it together, and then he starts to knead it with his hands, and knead it. And then there's this steel little device, you know, after you let the dough sit a little bit, and he ran it through by hand, you know, these rollers, and then ultimately the cutter. And from that point in my life, I must have been 17, I think, I said, I have to do that. And then I ate the food that he made, and I never went back.
Yeah,
you know?
I mean, this is what I find fascinating. And everyone that I've talked to that has a reinvention story, there's these little progressions that they don't even know that every step, these things that were passions, these things that lit them up inside. Right. When you talk about it, you know, you're here in the studio with me, you light up.
Yeah,
and then you know you're onto something.
Yeah, yeah.
You know?
Well, that's the response I got from those people that initially went with me to Italy, said, well, I'll just do this on my vacations, right? Well, then after the second time doing it like that, I'm like, what am I waiting for? You know, I don't wait till I retire.
We're not getting any younger here, right?
Let's make this business now. Because that passion came through the dinner table. Every night I make them a 5-course meal. They come home.
So let's talk about that, the Italian tours. How does that actually happen? Someone books you for a week?
You
plan the villa? I mean, what happens?
Yeah. Well, what I wanted to create was this immersion in, I want people who've done the Rome, Venice, Florence, you know, hop and skip tour. I want them after that. Everyone wants to see everything in Italy their first trip. And I get that because I did that too. I did a lot of that. But I want someone who wants to take their time and stay in a villa for 7 nights and go to day trips. You know, come down to breakfast in your slippers. There's, you know, there's none of this. You have to be here by the bus by this time, blah, 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 blah. You know, it's a group of 8 people or 6 people. And we just gently go through the week. So you're not like exhausted, but by Friday, you're like, wow, I'm so relaxed, but yet I saw all this stuff and all the food, and every night we had these great meals. And over the last 10 years, I became very interested in the actual food of Italy. Being Italian.
So you were telling me an interesting story about the cheese and the ricotta.
Yeah. Being Italian in America, we are Italian Americans. Our food got fused with the abundancy of America. These people moved here at the turn of the 20th century. They moved here with very, very little money. They didn't have meat in their diet. They wind up in New York City where they had the stuff available. So they incorporated it in their food. So the Italian food that you see in the United States is really not like what's in Italy. It's not that it's bad. People kind of snark at it. It's very delicious. It's good. It's a fusion. It's sort of like the Italians that went to Peru or, you know, Argentina. They fused it and it's delicious. But it's not really the authentic. So over 10 years, I would read books about the history of Italian food. For instance, like ricotta cheese, it's a 1,000-year-old recipe. And the poor people, the peasants, took the byproduct from the cheesemaker. The rich people had the cows, they had the milk, they made the cheese. The whey that would sweat off as they cooked the cheese would be thrown away. Well, starvation creates great opportunities for invention. And the poor people took that byproduct and recooked it and made ricotta cheese 1,000 years ago. So that is, you know, it means twice cooked, the words. So that, you know, to me, that means a lot to me. I make a dish, saltimbocca alla romana, Romagna. That is using fontina cheese, where in the 12th century, that cheese was developed in the Alps when the cows would go up in the spring and eat the new grass. And that was the most flavor, you know, fontina cheese that you could get. And that's incorporated in that veal dish. So it's really cool.
Oh, it is cool. The history and the fact that you're so fascinated by all that. But I want to get to some of the other things that you do too, because that's part of that reinvention. You didn't just stop with Italian culinary tours. And that's something that someone could get in touch with you and find out about. And I want to make sure that we do that.
Right.
But you've got a company called Ciao Bella Productions. You're also a tour guide at Key Culinary Tours, which is where I met you.
Right.
You do that.
Right.
And then tell me about the dinner theater in your home. That's a fascinating thing.
Yeah. So over these years that I've read and studied, you know, I read a book titled How Italian Food Conquered the World. He's a first generation Italian author. He's a food critic, New York City, John Marinardi. And he wrote this book about this influence and why did it become so popular. So I created dishes that I could tell stories from the book, and between each course, we do 8 courses, I would tell stories. You know, where does marinara sauce, where did that generate? Well, it started in Naples, and the fishermen needed something to put in their ship that would preserve itself. The acid from the tomato, the salt they added to the paste, right? They would bake it in the sun and reduce it to what we call tomato paste. They call it extract. And they put it in kegs, and then they'd have dry pasta, pull up the water from the sea. That's why they say you should always salt your water for pasta as the Mediterranean salt level, you know?
Wow, okay.
So then they could have this dish that was very well preserved and compact that would go on a ship if they were out.
So hence
the sauce, the mariner sauce. These were mariners who used the sauce.
So this dinner theater is something that someone would hire you to come into their
home.
That's right. And you said there's like 7 courses, an opera singer.
We make their home the stage.
Fun.
So between each course, they tell these stories. We have the food, and an opera singer sings stories. Like we talk about 5 million Italians moving in a 40-year period or 20-year period at the turn of the century. So she sings the Titanic theme, "My Heart Will Go On," I think it's called.
Right.
But she does it in Italian.
Oh,
it's
nice.
Really sweet.
Oh,
and by the end of the night, they're all like singing at the end.
So if you can't afford to have that kind of an extravagant evening with your friends, there are lots of other ways that people can get exposed to you on May 1st and 13th and 14th. Tell me about some of those events that you have. We only have a minute and a half.
Okay. So there's a food and travel festival going on May 1st at the Sawgrass Farms. That's here in Sarasota in the North End. There is on May 17th, I'm doing a dinner called The Art of Olive Oil at Mazzoni Olive Oil Store. That's in the South Trail. And on the 15th, that's a little pricey, on the 15th is Oslo's Theater's Men Who Cook.
Fun.
I'm one of the chefs at Men Who Cook.
But there's something on the 13th and 14th also, I think.
Oh, that's simple. That'll be a wine tasting, an Italian wine tasting. at Morton's Gourmet Market, where I will be making pasta in the store that people can sample.
Okay, and now people want to get a hold of you. They want to find out more about you. You've got a Facebook page.
Sure, Italian Culinary Culinary Tours is the Facebook page.
Say it all again.
Italian Culinary Tours.
Okay.
ItalianCulinaryTour.com is my website. And then there's Ciao Bella Productions. They can find stuff out there. And of course, KeyCulinaryTours.com, which is local here in Sarasota.
Right. And I had Susan Robinson in already. She's the owner of Key Culinary Tours.
Yeah, that's why her and I hit it off so well. We're two corporate people who moved into
an art form. Really,
yeah,
it is.
But my clients are still the same. You know, they're very fluent, they're well-traveled, and, you know, I just able to take care of them.
Well, thanks for bringing in those homemade biscottis. They're lovely, and I'm sure people will be coming out to Morton's, especially to come and see you. So thanks, Robert Gaglio. You are a joy. We'll be back in just a few seconds with more on What's New SRQ.
And thank you for having me.
My pleasure.